hairs go back. Way back. Back into time.
WUSB Stony Brook, and after weeks of preparing, it is now time for the Partridge Family's 45th anniversary show with Captain Rocket's Time Machine. Oh yeah. We're gonna make you happy all over again. A lot coming up. Stay right with me. It's gonna be fun tonight.
We'll be right back. good helper if our music would pay. Daddy got Reuben to sell our song, and it really came together when Mom sang along.
Come on now and meet everybody and hear us singing. There's nothing better than being together when we're singing. When we're singing. When we're singing.
The good times in the leaves of life. Life on a shelf.
Life on a shelf.
You're feeling sad, missing out on the fun, 'cause you're having none alone by yourself. Look through the tears that fill your eyes, yeah. And just throw up your troubles and leave them behind. You better let the good times in. Let love shine through.
Something that keeps knocking at my brain. Before I go insane, I hold my pillow to my head and spring up in my bed, screaming out the words I dread. I think I love you.
I think I love you.
This morning I woke up with this feeling I didn't know how to deal with, and so I just decided to myself I'd hide it to myself and never talk about it, and did not go and shout it when you walked into the room.
I think I love you.
Up against, I don't know what it's all about. I got so much to think about.
Hey,
don't have to worry. I only want to make you happy. And if you say, hey, go away, I will. But I think better still, I'd better stay around and love you. Do you think I have a case? Let me ask you to your face. Do you think you love me? I think I love you. I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
Okay, we jumped right out of the box with a whole bunch of stuff there. We got the I Think I Love Yous out of the way. So if you're going to call in and request any songs tonight at 632-6901, hey, you don't have to request I Think I Love You. And let's see, we had a couple of, one song right there, Let the Good Times In. That was the song that the Partridge Family sang on the first episode that David Cassidy did not sing in. And we're going to talk more about that later, but I got a feeling that if David Cassidy didn't open his mouth and start singing, we wouldn't probably be here tonight. Okay. We had a couple of versions of Come On, Get Happy. One which was a dance remix that David Cassidy did a few years ago. We also threw in the original first season version of the Partridge Family theme, which was the version that said, Danny got Reuben to play our song, and so on and so forth. It's 6:16. Yeah, you didn't know that? Yeah, no. You always think they're playing something else. I don't know what mic you're on, so I can't. Is this number 7?
I don't think I'm on any mic.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway, I'd like to just right now say thank you, and thank you for listening to a lot of people that I got a feeling right now are online from all around the world on their computers, like you just heard that computer going on. And we've got to welcome people from all over the United States and Canada to WUSB Stony Brook and WUSB.FM. We've got people, and I know they're listening, or they may be listening to the replay tomorrow, from all the way from the UK, from Germany. We've got people listening from Australia, and it's going to be a really great show tonight. It was extended till 4 hours. We're going to be here till 10 o'clock. There's going to be plenty of time.
Seriously,
there's going to be plenty of time for a lot of things to happen. And the person talking in the background, maybe if they talk into the mic, we can get them on here.
I was talking to the mic.
No, the mic wasn't on.
The pot wasn't on.
Yes, that's it. Let's welcome Eve to the festival tonight, to festivities. And Mr. Bill is here too. And they both went with me to the David Cassidy concert the other day, but we'll get into that a little bit later. We saw David Cassidy at, can I remember the name of that place?
John J. Burns.
John J. Burns Park.
Massapequa.
Massapequa. It was a really cool time. But we'll talk about that later, as I said, because we've got guests to talk about. The first one's been hanging on the phone for almost like a half hour now. He's probably like chewed a telephone book by now. and that is Johnny Ray Miller. I got his name right. And he is an author. He is the author of a brand new book that is coming out in December on the Partridge Family's shows and music. It is called When We're Singing. And Johnny's going to be with us. Not only do we have him on the phone here, but he's kind of turned out from a guest into kind of like a co-host. He's going to be with us the whole 4 hours. He's going to stay here, and he's going to be with me on the station breaks, and he's going to give everybody some insight into the music and some of the music they never heard of and the songwriters and a lot of stuff like that. So it's going to be really a great time with Johnny. Johnny, hang on one more minute. We got to go through the guest list because we have another very special guest that was only advertised only for the last day and a half. So if you haven't been on Facebook the last day and a half or haven't read about the show, we do have another special guest who will be in here, not in here, but on here, via telephone after the 8 o'clock hour. And believe it or not, we have Brian Chris Partridge Foster is going to be on WUSB tonight. He's calling in. He played Chris Partridge on the second, third, and fourth seasons of The Honeymooners. Where am I going with this? Okay. He played Ralph Cramden. Cramden in the movie The Honeymooners. Okay, so it is going to be fun. Brian will be here. He's going to get grilled by Captain Rocket about his days in the Partridge Family. But that's going to be later on, so I hope there's a lot of people out there that are excited for that, because we have a Partridge. But right now, we have Johnny Ray Miller, and he is waiting on the line to talk about his new book, and I think now we can bring him on. Johnny, are you with us?
If you flip that switch,
Roger,
oh,
here.
Oh, good. Yeah. Okay. Oh,
it's you know what, Eve? I've worked here for quite a while.
The program. Yeah, the program.
I know.
You're listening through the
speaker. I know, but yeah.
Okay. There you go. Now he's on.
Okay, Johnny.
I'm here. Here.
Yes, you're here. We're going to test your volume so that you're not too loud for the public. Go ahead. Say my name is Johnny Ray Miller, and I've got a secret. Okay, Johnny.
Well, thanks for having me on, Roger. I really appreciate it. I'm really excited about all of this, to talk about the Partridge Family and the music, and couldn't be more excited.
And you're at a perfect level, too. I just was testing your level on that thing, so we're going to keep you at this level all night, and you should be fine. Okay, so as I told you, John has written a book about the Partridge Family. It is called When We're Singing. And it will be available in December. We will be giving away a couple copies tonight, doing some trivia, some Partridge Family trivia. You will not get the book until December, but you will be kept on a list. And when the book is ready, it will be sent to you. And John is going to personally autograph those two copies that we are going to have sent out for trivia winners. So, John, I guess the first place I'd like to start with the book is, I guess I'd really, you know, want to know, well, the people want to know, I kind of know, because John, you feel like you're an old friend now. We've talked so much about the Partridge Family the past couple of weeks.
Yeah,
it's like I've known you forever now. So,
we
got to go through it again for the people listening.
Sure.
So we want to, basically, your history with the Partridge Family, you are from, you know, I don't want to say self-proclaimed, but you are proclaimed to be one of the Partridge Family experts in the entire world on the subject. And
that's really flattering. I don't know how this how it ever came to be this, but it's
maybe I started that rumor.
Flattering.
I don't know.
I am. You know my story. I have a background in the theater, and I worked in several theaters as managing director, executive director, general manager. Business from behind the scenes in bringing in entertainment and booking shows, and I have a background as a performer and a director, so strong theater background. And I was working at a theater in Franklin, Pennsylvania, and it was 2009. I hadn't been there that long, and being a lifelong Partridge Family fan and huge David Cassidy fan, I thought, I wonder if I could get David Cassidy to come to the theater for a show. And so, you know, I just started digging into it, and we put together a show with him, and it was phenomenally successful. It was one of the most successful shows that the theater had seen, and I can't tell you how exciting it was, you know, to bring your childhood idol in to do something like that. It was definitely kind of a dream come true. So when everything went so well, and as time passed and I left that position, I kept thinking in the back of my head, you know, you know, what could the next thing be? And I had been hoping, as Partridge Family fans, we've all wanted a good book about the Partridge Family, especially about the music, because nothing's ever been written about the music. Really, almost virtually nothing. And all of these, as you know, great songwriters and singers and musicians worked on this music. And so, you know, when others that I thought maybe might write this book never did, that we all kind of dreamed for, I thought, why not me? Why don't I give it a go? And so I just picked up the phone and, you know, thought, well, let's give this a shot. I knew that I had had a great experience with David Cassidy. I felt like, you know, that there was a lot of support there from him, and I thought, okay, I need to get Shirley Jones on board. If I can get Shirley Jones on board, I'll go forward with it. So I approached Shirley Jones people, and about a month after that, I had a meeting with Shirley Jones in the first interview, and I mean, you can imagine the doors just started to open then. And flipping over to the musician side of it, I had a connection that was a friend of a friend of a friend kind of a story through Cleveland, who knew Denny Tedesco, the son of the late, great Tommy Tedesco, who was one of the greatest guitar players from, you know, the session player years of all time. And so I called him, and he hooked me up with Denny, and then Denny, who had just made this film called The Wrecking Crew about those session players, and he was in the throes of getting the rest of the movie funded. He had finished the film, and he was getting funding for it, and we talked, you know, we sort of had a bond there approaching these kinds of things, and he hooked me up with Hal Blaine, who is one of the greatest drummers of all time. In fact, the guy who is often credited as coining the phrase "the Wrecking Crew." And so my next interview was with Hal Blaine, and Hal Blaine then literally opened up his little black book, and he must have given me 20 phone numbers that day. And you know, which nothing like that ever happened after that. It was not that extreme. But it was just that the snowball was rolling down the hill, and it just kept getting bigger, and it just seemed like go, go, go.
You need
kept rolling with it, and, you know, here we are. I can't believe it, to tell you the truth. It's really exciting, and, you know, it's been a wild, fun 5 years to get to the point where I'm at now, which I never dreamed it would ever take that long. But, you know, I think when you're passionate about something and you do something of the heart, you're not on this commitment to finish something in 6 months or a year. So it just took the time that it took. And here we are. I can't believe it.
Sometimes you got to, you know, like in sports, they say, well, you got to be lucky to be good. So sometimes you got to get lucky and you hit into the right people and the right things happen. And then, you know, stuff, like you said, it became a steam train going down a hill. And that's how it worked out for you. And that's a good thing.
That's exactly how it was. It just seemed as though, you know, one thing right after another, it just seemed so very meant to be. You know, not too much in life goes that way.
Right.
I was so thrilled, you know, that it panned out that way, and, you know, here we are. So
you're probably only going to write one Partridge Family book, okay? You might as well wait until you got it 100% right. You don't have, you know, there's no point in rushing to get something out. You want to make sure that you've got everything right. So I understand that.
You know, there was never, which is kind of strange to me, there was never a book before this other than one book in 9-4 that pretty much was more of an episode guide. Mm-hmm. It's a fun little anecdotal episode type guide that those were real popular, you know, in the 90s on all the TV shows. But nothing, you know, really serious about the music, and even the TV show stuff, the story of the TV show, I've included that, but a lot of that got covered in made-for-TV specials and documentaries, you know, when the things on those shows on Behind the Music and shows like that that were really popular, biography. So some of that can be seen there, but you know, I put it all together because I felt like, you know, it needed to be all together, but I put the focus on the music because nothing really has been told about the music before.
Right. So basically the book is about the Partridge Family music. It's not a lot about the day-to-day of the episodes or this TV show.
No. I do tell the story of the Partridge Family and, you know, their fun stories of being on the set together and, you know, how the show progressed from season to season. Because the interesting thing with this body of music is that it's so unique because it spawned itself from a television show, and it was planned to go that way. You know, they knew what they wanted when they started with the show, but they had no idea just what they were going to get, which was, you know, the world's biggest teen idol of all time and, right, and a voice like David Cassidy's. And so, you know, it was just monstrous whenever it exploded, and it exploded very early, too. So the story of the TV show does tie into the story of the music, so I've included all of that. You know, and I have fun stories from the cast members and the producers, some producers who had never been interviewed about the show before, which I find exciting because they have, you know, they had fresh things to tell that's never been told. I spoke with Bernard Slade, who created the show, and Bob Claver, who was the executive producer of the show, and a lot of fun stories. It was a very positive experience for everyone involved, it seems. At least, you know, that's my take on it.
Well, that's good. There's we talked about this briefly off, you know, a couple of days ago, and I started that little first set with a song in there from it's on the Greatest Hits CD now, but it was never released before, and it was one of those songs that was there without David Cassidy singing. There was a few of them, but that was called Let the Good Times In. And I had said to you, and I said it on the air before, I don't know if you heard me, that if you know, that wasn't a pleasant song. And the first
episode, it was terrific.
The music was pleasant in the first episode, but
yeah, that song appeared in the first episode. They used it in the first episode. The first time, in fact, we ever hear the Partridge Family quote unquote play music, you know, on the show was in their garage, and that was the song that they played. And at that point, no one knew David Cassidy could sing, and so it was all lip syncing. And you know, one of the things that I find really interesting about that song, and this is sort of a testament to this music and what it really is. See, the image is part of the story, and you know, it's got its pros and cons. The image sold the music, but the music stood on its own. So, you know, one had the other, but what we really have here is a body of music that is as credible as any other easy listening type band. In my opinion, it's not bubblegum music, and most of the people who worked on it didn't feel that way either.
No, I don't call it bubblegum music. That's definitely
You know, bubblegum music is a little more.
What is bubblegum music?
Kind of a late '60s, yummy, yummy, yummy. I got love in my tummy kind of thing, and the Archies. But you know, even though it was marketed that way, if you listen to it, if you pop that CD in the player and don't tell anybody who it is and play the music and see what you get, they'll be like, "Who is that?" You know, they'll be going, "Who is that?" Because it stands on its own. It's easy listening music, adult contemporary music of the day, and the image was powerful on top of it. But what's underneath of it 45 years later is what we're looking at here, and that is important music, music that needs its story told, and it needs to be looked at with the kind of respect that all the rest of the adult contemporary music of the day should be looked at.
Right. And we're going to be playing a lot of music tonight that people are going to hear for the first time, because there was 8 albums, including a Christmas album, put out in less than a 4-year period. I believe it was like 3.5 years. And a lot of the music did not get out there. You know, people know those first handful of hits, and there's a lot of really good music. I mean, their last album, I thought, was one of their better ones. And there's a song on there that we will play later, I'll Never Get Over You, I believe, which to me...
Tony Romeo's song.
Yeah, it's a Tony Romeo song. To me, if that was on the first CD, that would have been a number one, you know, that would have been a smash. But it ended up not getting written until a few years later, and because it just sounds like one of the best of the Partridge Family records. So a lot of people are going to hear a lot of stuff tonight that they never heard, unless they're, of course, you know, a big fan and they buy everything. But a lot of people don't do that. A lot of people buy the greatest hits and they don't know a lot more songs, and they're gonna put their heads together after a while and say, "Wow, you know, I missed a lot of music," because I felt that way. I did not listen to all those Partridge Family albums until some years later, and then I realized that there was more to them than just "I Think I Love You." As a matter of fact, "I Think I Love You" to me wasn't the end all song for me, because you know, it was light and fluffy. It was a nice song, but kind of like as a 13-year-old, a teenager, the teenage angst of like, say, "Doesn't Somebody Want to Be Wanted" hit me a little harder, you know, at home than say the fluffiness of say of "I Think I Love You." But
you know what's really interesting to me about that, as something that I talk about in the book too, is even though the Partridge Family was predominantly followed outspokenly by young girls, there was a lot of boys who loved the Partridge Family. And what's interesting is if you talk to men about what their favorites were and are, and women, you often get very different choices.
Well, I do an oldies show on this station all the time, and I do get phone calls, people asking for Partridge Family songs, and they're usually men. I will tell you that. I get them calling up asking for "I Woke Up in Love This Morning," "I'll Meet You Halfway." So it's not, is not all women nowadays. I'm getting, and these guys have got to be in there, I'm sure they're in their 50s, and they're calling up this radio station asking me to play "I Woke Up in Love This Morning" by the Partridge Family. So you're
pretty I really believe that's because it's about the music.
Yes.
The music has held up.
Yeah.
And because it's held up, you know, the audience is still out there. And when they get a chance to find the music, they do.
It doesn't matter that it was a TV show or that it was, what it was or whatever at that time. If you like the song, you like the song. And I'm not one that betrays what I've always liked. There's some people, you know, they don't want to admit now that they like the Partridge Family or the Monkees or whatever it is. I don't ditch the stuff that I grew up with, that the memories that, you know, that I live with, still live with from a childhood. I don't ditch what I liked.
And I think, don't you think a lot of that comes from, too, you know, you get a point to a point in life where you're looking back and, you know, you grab a hold of the things, well, that made you happy and gave you peace of mind and a little bit of calmness to your day. And the other part of that, too, is that, you know, at that time, like in the late 60s and early 70s, people were really identified often by their music. It, you know, it was such a different changing time, and music, for a lot of people, it defined them. And, you know, I don't know that that's so true nowadays. I can't say that I'm, you know, the most hip to the times guy here about, you know, what the youth is like and what they're listening to, but I don't get the feeling that they're just defining themselves by their music. They definitely seem to like all kinds of music, old and new. It just seems like it's a little bit more, oh, I don't know. The trend now is to just be open and take a look at what's out there and embrace it all from the past to the present.
Because there's a lot of ways for music to be delivered today. It's not, if you know, you don't have to be stuck listening to the top 40 station that plays 40 songs. You've got tremendous amounts of things to listen to. You've got, you know, iPods where you can put your own music. You've got satellite radio, Sirius radio, all these various things where you could, you know, go crazy and listen to all kinds of different things. The one point I wanted to make, which we kind of skirted past, when it came to those first few songs that David Cassidy was not singing, I wonder how that would have affected the ratings if they continued to play. If David Cassidy couldn't sing, you know, let's say David Cassidy wasn't a singer, he was just the actor. Would that, you know, those shows were funny. They did stand up on their own. I've been watching them. You know, I watched all of them a few years ago when the DVDs came out, and I have been watching them recently. And they are very funny shows, music notwithstanding. The stories and are very funny. So, but without that push that was created with the I Think I Love You, would we be sitting here talking about this? Would we be here? Because you cannot convince me that there would have been 8 albums of that generic studio musician Partridge Family music.
Yeah, no, I can't imagine that would have happened without the voice of David Cassidy.
No, we're not here.
He was an amazing discovery. And, you know, again, it's sort of like one of those deals where, you know, the snowball started going down the hill and all the green light was go, and everything just, the synchronicity of putting that all together and making it happen and come and having this fantastic music that was in sync with this television show, it was just, you know, you talk about the perfect time capsule. It really was very special. I don't think it would have taken off at all the way that it did without the voice of David Cassidy in the lead.
No.
But it's not to say, too, that people don't love, like, that song that you were playing, Let the Good Times In. People
right.
do love that
it's
song.
It's a nice song.
Because it was one of the unreleased songs. And, I mean, I know you're going to play these going forward, but as you know, and the fans know, there were a few songs that David Cassidy's lead vocal was not on in the first album.
Right.
This is a very good album, has several songs.
Right.
And the songs are very good. That leads its way into the people that they had working
right.
on these Partridge Family
but
albums.
Honestly,
I mean,
John,
not just brilliant musicians mm-hmm. that were playing on all the top records of the day, but the background vocalists. I mean,
right.
they were kind of known as the Wrecking Crew, too. They were going session to session, and those voices were, you know, the best, many have told me, the best 4 session vocalists available
mm-hmm.
That were out there. And those guys knew what they were doing.
Yeah.
And on top of it, they were in sync.
Yeah.
I talk a lot about that, too, in the book, about the synchronicity that I feel was there between David Cassidy and songwriters, like Tony Romeo especially. John Baylor, who was the vocal arranger and one of those background vocalists, they were in sync, and they just knew, you know how that is, when you, that those rare moments where you have something in life where you discover that chemistry was there. And there was even more. Mike Melvoin, who was the musical arranger on almost all of them, was just as in sync with David Cassidy and John Baylor and Tony Romeo. They just, that magic was there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that has a lot to do with, you know, the success of the songs that don't have David Cassidy on them.
Right.
But, you know, David Cassidy is the reason. He
right.
sold those albums. He sold those songs. And without his voice, I can't imagine, you know, I just can't imagine that it would have been even half. I can't even imagine there would have been half that number of albums, if there might have even been one or two, or if it even would have taken off, because it was really, you know, David Cassidy went out, and Wes Farrell was, who produced the albums, was pushing this music really hard in the very beginning, and they worked hard to get it recognized. And once it broke, you know, everybody was applauding Wes Farrell and Tony Romeo and David Cassidy, and, you know, well, you've seen what it's become.
Right. Well, I'll tell you this. I was 13 years old at the time that the Partridge Family came on, and the album came out, and I Think I Love You was a big hit. But I could tell you right now, I would not have bought Let the Good Times In, because I was a singles buyer. There's no way, if that even made the radio, which I doubt it would have, there's no way I would have bought that. There's no way I would have bought that music, that generic type music. David Cassidy, you know, took over, and he was the only reason that I, and I think millions of others, bought those songs. I do not think that the albums would have sold at all, very, very little, and I don't think the show would have lasted more than a couple seasons, only because, even though the show was good, I think the music drove it. So
do I.
Yeah.
I mean, and you know, one of the things, if you take even a look at the shows, and even if you watch other TV shows where they try to do a little musical thing, where some particular show might be trying to launch a musical act from their television show, David Cassidy has charisma. He still has that to this very day. And it just resonates from the screen. Even though we all know that they weren't really playing the instruments, David Cassidy knew how to play that instrument. Mm-hmm. And David Cassidy knew how to sing. And so the fact that that was real for him, and that Shirley Jones was really a singer, you know, the fact that there was legitimacy behind the scenes, and people knew it, as time went on, for sure, people knew it, and they knew about Shirley Jones, but there's a believability there, and that believability just, you know, the talent proved itself, and, you know, David Cassidy, people couldn't take their eyes off of him. I think those video sequences in the Partridge Family, the music videos, are some of the, you know, greatest moments of the show. David Cassidy is in control of those videos. You can tell when you watch them. And even though you look back, it's fun to poke, you know, the poke fun at, oh, the red crushed velvet. It's David Cassidy makes a lot of jokes about it, and when you see him in concert, he's really funny about it. But, you know, he always talks about how appreciative he was of those times and the good times that he had. And, you know, that's the kind of stuff that we all like to look back on and go, yeah, you know.
Well, he must have charisma, because Eve's been in love with him for 45 years now, at least.
I love that. You know, I love this. I saw this thing on TV where a couple years back he was a guest on Katie Couric's show. Mm-hmm. I guess it's many years now, and she had a big crush on him, and she was like a little schoolgirl. I mean, it was kind of funny watching her get all blushy around David Cassidy. It was really funny.
Yeah, well, we had, you know, Mr. Bill here and I had to try to keep her from rushing the stage on Saturday night.
I love that.
She wanted to go rush the stage.
You still got it, man. I mean, you know, I'm a huge fan.
I didn't have enough money to bail her out later on, so we had to stop her.
So, yeah.
So anyway, what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to stop you and give you a little rest, because you've been on a roll there, and I'm going to give you a little break, and we're going to play some songs, and we're going to give away the first book, the first copy of Johnny Ray Miller's book. I got his name right for the second time.
Give the phone number.
That's great.
Okay, we're going to give you a trivia question. And Johnny, you know the answer to this question. You can't call in and win. Okay.
Oh, come on.
No. So, what the question is, and Eve and Mr. Bill will answer the phones, and we're going to take the first person that answers this question correctly, and you will get an autographed copy of Johnny Ray Miller's book, When We're Singing, when it comes out in December. The question is, and this is going to jump, we're going to jump over to the UK. I don't know if anybody from the UK wants to call in and win, but the question is, what is the Partridge Family's biggest hit in the United Kingdom? What was their biggest hit? I'm going to eliminate right off the bat, I Think I Love You, because that is not the answer. That will keep 50 people from calling and saying, I Think I Love You. That is not the answer. So what we want to do is find out what was the biggest Partridge Family hit in the UK. Call us as soon as the music starts at 631-632-6901. The first one to get the correct answer will win the first copy of Johnny Ray Miller's book, when we're singing. We're going to play some music now. We're going to get back into some Partridge Family stuff, and Johnny will be back in a little while to talk about that stuff. But right now, get on the phone with your answers. This is 90.1 FM WUSB Stony Brook, and you are listening to the Partridge Family 45th Anniversary Special, going on till 10 o'clock tonight.
She came with the rain, scarlet ribbon in her hair. I never even knew her name. She just slipped away from me to who knows where. And if it weren't for the rain, she might still be there.
Rainmaker, does she have to be free? I guess you know she took the best part.
Come back to me. Love was only yesterday, and now tomorrow waits in vain. She never promised me she'd stay, so a stranger to my love she will remain. Back to me.
Face wherever I go. She didn't say it, but I know she doesn't love me.
I thought that I was king. She didn't want to play my game. If I had the sun to give her in the morning, she'd rather have the rain.
Just can't come true. I know there's nothing I can do to make her want me.
I could take the sun from heaven, tie it to a silver chain, bring it so it shines upon her through the morning. She'd rather have the rain.
Somebody want to give her everything, but it hurts when she doesn't hear
the song that you sing.
She's
theater. She'll be kind of shy and real good looking too. I'll be certain she's my girl by the things she'll like to do. Like walking in the rain and wishing on a star above the moon, being so in love. When she leaves me, whoa, whoa, I'll miss her. But sometimes we might fight, I won't really care. And I know it's gonna be alright, 'cause we got so much to so in love. No, no, she'll never do. No, it isn't her to. They would never. No, they'll never, never, ever love. Like walking in the rain and so in love. Like walking in the rain and wishing on a star above the moon, and so in love. Like walking in the rain.
I'd say we're sufficiently wet now. This is like that beach show we did last week where we constantly got drowned out. Anyway, a few rain songs in a row, and I just breaking in to say that we're getting plenty of phone calls, but we do not have a winner yet on our Johnny Ray Miller book, When We're Singing. The first autographed copy goes to the first person that calls at 632-6901, 63 area code, and tells us what was the Partridge Family's biggest hit in the UK. Here comes a hint, okay? It was not an original Partridge Family song. It was a remake of an early 60s hit by someone else, a pretty big song singer-songwriter. So try that out while we dry out in the sunshine at 90.1 FM, WUSB Stony Brook.
I've got the sunshine in my hands. You've got the sunshine in your hands. We've got the sunshine in our hands. Now let it shine all over this land. You've got to love, love one another. Whoa, shine, shine on your brother, and the whole world will discover in the arms of every woman and man. You've got the sunshine in our hands. I've got the sunshine in my hands. You've got the sunshine in your hands. Now let it shine all over this land. The whole world will discover in the
the arms of every woman and man.
You got the sunshine, we got the sun.
I got the sunshine in my hands. You got the sun.
Nights when you turn out the lights and you sit in the dark and say to yourself, I miss her. It's one of those moods when your body broods and you conjure up her picture and you kiss her. It's one of those things for the pain it brings. You say to yourself, hey, couldn't I live without it? Well, I think so. On the other hand, I doubt it. Crashing through my mind like waves upon the shore,
like waves upon the shore.
And I nod my head, whoa, yes, love, I'd welcome you again if you knocked upon my door. If you did not seek you out, love, I'd track you down for sure, like a thousand times before.
Like a thousand times before.
Whoa, yes, love, I'd welcome you again, like you know I've done before. Yes, love, you know I did before. Yes, love, you know I did before. So it goes, it's a cold in the nose, it's a pain in the neck. It'll make you a wreck if it gets ya. It's so insane, cause through all the rain, when you ask yourself, could you do it again? You betcha. I hear a voice say, you got no chance, and it makes me mad. And I shout, oh yeah, who says so? Well, of course not, on the other hand, guess so.
Oh, suddenly she's crashing through my mind like waves upon the shore.
Like waves upon the shore.
And I nod my head, whoa, yes, love, I'd welcome you again if you knocked upon my door.
If you knocked upon my door.
If you did not seek you out, love, I'd track you down for sure, like a thousand times before.
Love, I'd welcome you again, like you know I did before. Yes, love, you know I did before. Yes, love, you know I did before.
No more calls, folks. We have a winner at 90.1 FM, WUSP, Stony Brook.
When my friends told me you had someone new,